Macmillan Audio presents The Adventuress by Tasha Alexander. Read for you by Bianca Amato. He must needs go that the devil drives. William Shakespeare, All's Well That Ends Well. Chapter 1. The English Duke is dead. The words, muffled and heavily accented, hardly reached me through the voluminous duvet that while I slept had somehow twisted around me with such violence that it now more closely resembled mummy wrappings than a blanket. Struggling against its bonds, I managed to extricate one hand before realizing my head was under a stack of pillows. I flung them aside and sat up, turning to discover my husband was no longer next to me. The words came again, and this time vanquished in an instant all of the confusion clouding my mind after being woken up from a deep slumber. "Monsieur, the Duke, the English Duke, he is dead." "Jeremy?" I leapt from the bed, dragging the duvet with me. I had not been quite so successful in the removal of it from my person as I'd hoped, and started for the narrow patch of light coming into our room from the door, held open by my husband, his dressing gown pulled around him. A chasm seemed to open inside me, as if my heart was splitting, and filling me simultaneously with intolerable cold and heat. Jeremy Sheffield, Duke of Bainbridge, my dearest childhood friend, who had tormented me in my youth not quite so much as I had tormented him, could not be dead. I tried to step forward, but my limbs would obey no commands. "Is he in his suite?" my husband asked. The man standing in the corridor nodded. "I shall come at once." He must have closed the door, but I have no memory of him having done so. I collapsed in an undignified heap, my legs no longer able to support me. "Emily." Colin knelt at my side, scooped me into his arms and deposited me back onto the bed. "I must see what has happened and will return as quickly as possible. Will you be all right?" "Yes, of course." I rubbed my face. No, I must come with you." "I don't think you ought." His dark eyes locked onto mine, and I could see pain and worry and just a bit of frustration in them. "I have to see him. I know." He squeezed my hand and slipped the dressing gown from his shoulders, finding and putting on the stiff boiled shirt he had discarded earlier in the evening, with entirely no regard for its subsequent condition. After retrieving his trousers from the back of a chair and locating his shoes, one had disappeared under the bed, he shrugged into his tailcoat and walked to the door, pausing to turn back and look at me as he opened it. Had I not been so upset, I would have better appreciated the handsome dishevelment of his cobbled-together evening kit. "I'm so terribly sorry, Emily." The tears didn't come before the door clicked shut behind him, but then my eyes produced a worthy monsoon. Sudden storms are short, however, and this was no time for succumbing to emotion. I splashed water on my face and pulled on my dressing gown. There could be no question of returning to my own previously discarded garments. Ladies' gowns are designed to require assistance, and while this may allow for a more beautifully designed bodice, it proves an immense frustration when one finds oneself on one's own. Fortunately, no one saw me slip out of our room, as there were not yet other guests meandering through the Hotel Britannia, the most fashionable place to stay on La Croisette in Cannes, and arguably on the whole of the Côte d'Azur. A clock near the curved marble staircase told me it was nearly 5:30 in the morning. Anyone awake now would either be a servant or someone staggering in from a long evening, probably spent playing baccarat at the Cercle Nautique. I climbed one flight to the top floor, where Jeremy had insisted on staying. The view, he said, was incomparable. His door was closed and locked, so I tapped on it, and a man I didn't recognize opened it without delay. "Madame, you would not wish..." I pushed past him and went straight through the sitting room to the bedroom, when I saw my husband standing with two other men. On the bed was the prostrate form of a gentleman in evening kit. I recognized the wiry individual closest to the supine figure as the hotel doctor. He adjusted the tortoise-shell pince-nez on his long nose and placed his unopened bag on a bedside table. "We will need to further examine him, of course, but there is no question, I said, stepping forward with no regard for any of them, because this is not the Duke. Emily. Colin reached for my arm, but I pulled away and moved to the opposite side of the bed, closer to the body, determined to confirm the identity of the man. It was harder to move him than I'd anticipated, but I managed to roll him over and reveal his face, the eyes staring and vacant. Chauncey Neville. I was shaking rather violently now, and realized that I was barefoot and my teeth were chattering. It is not Jeremy. Not Jeremy. Mr. Neville, a shy, soft-spoken gentleman from Cornwall, had always seemed an unlikely friend for Jeremy, but the two had been close since their days at school. We often joked that they tempered each other, Chauncey reeling in Jeremy when he got too out of hand, and Jeremy prodding Chauncey to embrace joviality. Shy though he was, Mr. Neville never proved awkward in social situations, but instead was kind and thoughtful, always on hand to support his friends in any of their schemes. "Come, my dear," Colin said. "You will catch your death of cold. You know how chilly the seaside gets at night." Any person who has had the privilege of forming even the barest sort of acquaintance with Colin Hargreaves knows he's not the sort of gentleman to make such trite remarks. Rather, he is the most trusted agent of the Crown, a particular favourite of Queen Victoria's, and the individual most frequently called upon by the palace to assist in delicate matters that threaten the state of our great empire. My eyes focused better on the room now, and I saw the manager of the hotel wringing his hands. "Fear not, Monsieur Fortier, this is not the first body I have seen," I said. In fact, I had seen many. The work my husband and I shared, sometimes in official capacities, sometimes when we chose on our own to help those in need of assistance, had led us to reveal the identities of no fewer than 9 cruel murderers. I was not a stranger to violent death. Whether my words soothed the concerned hotelier, I do not know. Colin removed me to our own suite of rooms before I could gauge the man's reaction. Regardless, the untimely demise of one of our party would dramatically alter what had been intended as a celebratory holiday on the Côte d'Azur. Nearly 4 months ago, at Christmas, I had received a telegram from Jeremy announcing his engagement to Miss Amity Wells, an American heiress who had realized her parents' dearest hopes by catching an English duke. Miss Wells's mother, a veritable battle-axe of a woman, far better suited to roping steers on the range than moving in high society, insisted on throwing an engagement party to celebrate the match, but would not content herself with a ball in Mayfair. Instead, she had planned a trip to the south of France, where all the closest friends and family of the bride and groom would spend a fortnight, culminating in a party she assured us would be more spectacular than any we had ever seen. England, she explained in a coarse whisper, was such a little island it couldn't possibly be expected to hold all her big ideas. Colin and I had met mother and daughter over New Year at Jeremy's estate in Kent. The Wellses had cut short a trip to Egypt for the occasion. While Mrs. Wells could be described as a force of nature, one had to accept Amity as something akin to a dream. Her fresh-faced beauty, enviable figure, flair for fashion, and quick wit made her a favourite in London society. A favourite with the gentlemen, that is. I'm sorry to say that my own fair sex proved far less generous with her, a judgment firmly footed in the lair of envy. I scorned this, knowing it to be unfair, but must acknowledge that my reaction to Miss Wells proved somewhat more complicated than I should have liked. The estate of the Duke of Bainbridge lay adjacent to that of my own excellent father, and Jeremy and I had been inseparable as children. When it came time for him to leave for school, I cried for 3 days straight, and marked on my calendar when he would be home between terms, counting the weeks until I would see him again. By the time he had finished at Harrow and was leaving for Oxford, we no longer climbed trees together, instead finding great amusement in the knowledge that both our mothers longed to see us and our families united in marriage. Neither of us could think of anything more ridiculous, for although we adored each other, our temperaments and our interests couldn't have been more at odds. I had grown up studious and intellectual. Jeremy had championed the goal of being the most useless man in England. When his father died suddenly during his son's second year at university, everyone hoped the new Duke would undergo a transformation a la Prince Hal and adopt a more solemn and appropriate demeanour. This served only to spur him into more questionable behaviour. Jeremy played the rake with consummate skill, but at heart his kindness and steadfast loyalty prevented him from ever becoming truly profligate. He claimed this to be his greatest disappointment. He took splendid care of his mother, refusing to let her be holed up in dowager quarters, and knowing both what an asset she had been to his father and how much she had enjoyed helping to run the estate, insisted that she continue her work. He did as little as possible, squeaked through Oxford with a degree he claimed disgraced every Bainbridge ancestor, ran with a fast set, and perhaps drank too much on occasion, but he never got himself into irreparable trouble. Everyone in society fawned over him, particularly the legion of mothers who longed for the dashing, fun-loving Duke, whose fortune was even more attractive than his bright blue eyes, to someday propose to one of their daughters. Over the years, Jeremy's steadfast resistance to marriage became the stuff of legends. He did everything in his not inconsiderable powers to avoid it, including pretending to court my close friend Margaret Michaels, née Seward. Their deception was born out of mutual need. Margaret, an American, had been sent to England, much like Amity Wells, to catch a titled husband. She, however, had no interest in such things, wanting instead to study at Oxford. She and Jeremy spent a season pretending to be in and out of love. Eventually, when he threw her over, at her insistence, of course, she pled a broken heart and convinced her parents that they must not try to force her into marriage until she had quite forgot the Duke. Jeremy let it be known, quietly, that he felt an English peer ought not marry an American, a sentiment lauded by the aforementioned legion of mothers. Their daughters vied for his attention with such implacable nerve that it began to make him quite unable to enjoy all the social functions in which he used to take such pleasure. Finding this condition unacceptable in the extreme, he decided to direct all of his affections toward me, his oldest friend. At the time, I was a young widow, my first husband having been murdered only a few months after our wedding. Out of mourning and back in society, I had fallen in love with Colin Hargreaves. And even after I had accepted his proposal of marriage, Jeremy refused to stop pressing his own suit. Not, mind you, because he actually loved me, but because he knew I would go along with his scheme. He viewed my engagement as a gift from the dear Lord himself. Society believed him to be heartbroken and devoted to a lady he couldn't have, and the legion of mothers could tolerate with relative equanimity waiting for him to recover from the blow my second marriage struck. Colin accepted this arrangement with good humour, knowing full well Jeremy had never been a threat to our marital happiness. He also knew that one day Jeremy would have to marry. He might play the profligate, but he would never leave his dukedom without an heir. Much as I enjoyed Jeremy's little game, I had rejoiced when I read his telegram and knew it was over. I longed to see my friend as happily settled as I. Then I met Amity Wells. I am perhaps not being entirely fair. She failed to make much of an impression at our first meeting, but balls don't provide much of an opportunity for deep conversation. Our trip to Cannes was to offer us that. Yet almost from the moment I stepped into La Croisette with her, I knew we could never be friends. And I feared Jeremy would never forgive me for that.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.